Hi, I'm Boriana. Welcome to my channel. In this video world, I'm going to give you my theory about Picasso, no less. I'm going to talk to you about dogs, geniuses, and billionaires' wives. So brace yourselves. Do you know the name of the artist who painted this masterpiece? Probably not. But you certainly know the name of the artist who painted this. Or this. Or this. The first artist is William Adolphe Bouguereau. He lived in the 19th century in France and was considered the world's greatest painter by the academic circles. He received numerous official honors and was paid top dollar for his work. And he was really a fine painter. His work is nothing short of beautiful, masterly, perfect. Yet he did not withstand the test of time. Nobody considers him a genius today. And then there is our bad boy Picasso, with his women with two noses and six fingers and four toes. His work can hardly be described as beautiful or perfect, right? Yet he's considered the most significant artist of the 20th century and a genius. So what's the catch? The answer, according to art history, is that Picasso, together with Georges Braque, invented cubism, a form of art which turned everything known as painting upside down. Not only that, he continued doing that for the rest of his long life. Cubism is a manner of painting where, instead of viewing an object from one central point of view, the artist painted from several points of view at the same time. So why is cubism, this unintelligible, certainly not pretty way of painting, such a big deal? And how did Picasso get there? Before we move on with my theory, I want to ask you, do you know who painted this picture? Well, Picasso did when he was 16. Can you believe it? At 16, he was an absolutely accomplished painter. Does this make him a genius, though? I would say not yet, but it proves that he had an exceptional gift. Do you want another one? Here. In the year 1900, Picasso arrives in Paris, Europe's cultural capital. It is the turn of the 20th century. The world is trying to cope with unprecedented speed of change, very much as it is doing today. Industrial revolution has transformed the way people work, live, travel, communicate. Novelties include trains, electricity, photography, cinema, typewriters. Science has shaken the foundations of religion, stripping life from its spiritual meaning as people knew it. The world is going through a true identity crisis. And art is turning to new concepts, trying to make sense of this new world. Picasso is right in the middle of the action, young, bright-eyed, hungry. He's already noted in the artistic circles. He takes part in the heated intellectual debates, and he spends his nights painting. So how did his soul-searching take him to the visual language which started as cubism and distinguished Picasso's work for the rest of his long life? In addition to the historical backdrop and the immediate artistic surroundings, I think there are two factors which are often misunderstood or underestimated by art historians. One of them is children's art. I believe the children's art had much bigger impact on Picasso than recognized. What rang my bell was his own words.
It took me 4 years to paint like Raphael and a lifetime to paint like a child. Every child is an artist. The problem is to remain an artist once they grow up.
Yes, we all know that children's drawings are spontaneous, direct. They don't follow rules or conventions. But let's scratch this surface a little bit deeper. Let's compare two images here. One of them is a drawing of a child, let's say 5-year-old. The other one is a painting by an adult. Which one do you say is truer to reality? The grown-up one, right? It's a no-brainer. But try to tell that the five-year-old. He'll be like, dude, everybody knows that a dog has four legs and two ears and two eyes. And look at yours. It only has three legs and one ear and one eye. And you cannot argue with a five-year-old because dogs in reality do have four legs and two ears and two eyes. Dogs in paintings don't. They can have two legs or three legs or whatever because they are not real dogs. They are illusions of dogs. So we have on one hand reality and on the other two ways of its depiction, the realistic one and the truthful one. Picasso chose truth over realism, even though truth didn't look as polished and pleasing to the eye as the illusionism of the realistic approach. Remember his words and look at these two images. Doesn't it look like a conscious choice, directly influenced by children's art? Then there is the influence of African art, another factor which I believe is misinterpreted by art historians. In the early summer of 1907, while looking at African art, Picasso had a revelation in his own words. And indeed, in the next 2 years, his work will be strongly influenced by those images. The official line is that Picasso was quite taken by the anatomical simplifications and expressive features of African sculptures and masks. But stop and think for a moment. Would he call it a revelation if it concerned only the shapes? I think there is something deeper than that here. The so-called primitive art is not really art in the Western sense. For the cultures which originated these objects, they believed to possess divine powers themselves. They are not just sacred symbols or representations of the divine. They are the divine. So that day at the Ethnographic Museum, Picasso realized that he was standing in front of art with purely spiritual function. It was right there in front of him, and this is what it looked like. Now, that's a revelation. The underlying principles of Picasso's work are to give priority of the truthful over the realistic and of meaning over appearance, which explains why his paintings look the way they do. He arrived at Cubism in a quest for truth beyond the obvious, the quest of a man who had the courage to break with all conventions and to go to the very sources, inside himself, discovering his inner child, and to the deepest roots of human civilization. Now, this is a genius. Picasso also redefined the meaning of an artwork from an expression of meaning to an autonomous object of meaning. His paintings are not about love, hope, horror. They are love, hope, sorrow, horror. He said,
"When I paint a wild horse, you may not see the horse, but you will see the wildness."
So, world, that was my theory about Picasso and why his art looks the way it does. Please let me know your thoughts in the comments below. Now, Bourguereau, in case you wonder. As the quintessential salon painter of his generation, he was reviled and rejected by the Impressionists. In the early 20th century, his work fell out of favor with the public due to changing tastes. Then, in the 80s, there was a revival in interest in figurative painting, which led to rediscovery of Bourguereau and his work, and his prices started climbing again. Nowadays, his work seems to be favored by certain billionaires' wives. And not that Renoir has been spared either.
Oh, no!
No disrespect. No. But I'd better shut up, huh? I hope you enjoyed this video. If yes, please give it a like, share with the good world, and subscribe. Thanks for watching. I hope to see you very soon. Bye.